The title of my message today is, and what's on my heart is, I've been preaching about renewing, restoring, or restoration, and reviving. And revive. And today is going to be the last that I am speaking on these subjects. But today is something that's burning in my heart, where what's burning in my heart today is that hearts would be revived. And I don't know about you, but there's times in our lives that we come to, and I believe it's each and every one of us. We come to places and we need to examine our hearts. And we look into our hearts, and sometimes we go our way and we don't think about our hearts and some of the thoughts and intentions and what is lying within us. But today I would ask, well, the burden that's on my heart is that we could examine our hearts. And what is the heart of man? It's the very essence. It's the mind, the will, and the emotions of who we are. It's in the very depth of who we are. That's our hearts. And I wonder if you really look and you start digging into who you really are, I would ask the question, who are you? And I'm asking it today to your heart. I'm not asking it only to that which you're hearing with your ears and maybe your mind only, but I'm asking this question to your very heart. Who are you? And I've asked myself this very question just recently, and God has been doing it last night as I was studying on this message, God just showed me things in my own heart. And there's such a cry that comes out from your innermost being that you want to be right before God, at your heart, that you want to be as clear as you can before Him. And I believe it comes down to honesty with ourselves of who we are. And honesty in our hearts. And when I say hearts today, I'm talking about that innermost being in the bosom of our hearts. Those things that we can hide away in our hearts. Those things that maybe no one else is aware of. Maybe some of those wounds and things that are in our hearts that we've carried for years. But maybe it's even tendencies that are wrong. Tendencies and evil thoughts. And we will look into some of this scripture today. And by the grace of God, it's going to be a short message today. I guess I should say, God willing. It's going to be up to Him. But the cry in my heart is that I need revival. I need revival in my own heart. Lord, revive. Revive some of the things that have been lost in my heart. Maybe some of the love that I had for You. And I looked into my own heart and I said, Lord, I need revival in my own heart. I need a touch from You again. I need that love to be there again. I need some of those things corrected again. And may I say like this, when we get honest with our hearts, God can do so much in an instant. By the power of the Holy Spirit and by Him touching our lives and touching our hearts, He can do so much in an instant of what we try to shape and form ourselves to be, sometimes in years. And there's many of us and there's many people we've tried for years to shape and form and not to do certain things and to do other things. But when the Spirit of God comes, when the Holy Spirit comes and He reigns, and the Lord is truly the one that reigns within our hearts. This is where things are taken care of. This is where God looks out for us. This is where the Holy Spirit speaks to us in our hearts. And He says there's a conviction within our hearts. There's sin that cannot be there any longer because of the presence of the holiness of God and who He is by the Holy Spirit. And this is what we need. We need His presence within us. And I wonder so many times as we go from year to year and the things that want to shape and form us from the outside, the things of the world and the things that want to wear us down and the enemy that comes against us, how that we're shaped and formed within our hearts. Is it God shaping and forming us by the power of the Holy Spirit? Or is it only the things that we're facing so many times? And may I say right with that, God uses things in our lives to shape and to form us and to mold us into His image. And this wasn't in my notes this morning, but there's a verse that says that we are, if I can get the beginning of it, that it's, and I'll have to paraphrase it because I don't know the exact words, but basically when we've given our lives unto Jesus Christ, we are predestinated to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. So any time that we as Christians, if you have given your life unto Jesus Christ and for Him to be Lord in your life, for Him to be seated on the throne of your life, this means that there has been a predestination that has taken place, or a predetermined thing that will happen in our lives. And this predetermined thing is that we will be formed and shaped into the image of Jesus Christ. And it says in another verse, it says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Jesus Christ." And this mind was a mind of, it talks about His humility and how that He humbled Himself and He came and He gave His life for us. It says it behooved Him to be made like unto His brothers so that He would be able to someday sit at the right hand of the Father and intercede for each one of us. But the predetermined thing that God says is that we, if we are given unto Him, what He's going to do, He's going to form Christ within us. Now, is there a miracle that takes place when we're born again? Absolutely. There's a seed that is put within us, and it's an incorruptible seed that has been put within our hearts. And this seed cannot be corrupted. That's what the Scripture says. This seed cannot be corrupted, but what becomes corrupted and is corrupted is our own way. It's the mind, will, and emotions. And unless God gives us a new heart and a new spirit, we're just playing games. We're just playing church. We're just trying to be somebody that's good and well, and the works that come out of our lives are all null and void. But when it's by the power, when we're born again, by the power of the Spirit of God, when He puts that incorruptible seed within our hearts, a seed that cannot be corrupted, when He puts that in there, hallelujah. This is what continues to be shaped and formed into the image of Jesus Christ. Just remember, the old flesh never becomes a part of that. The old flesh dies, and it dies. And there's 1,000 deaths that I believe somebody had preached that already. I think Wayne maybe. But there's 1,000 deaths that we have died. I can say that there's thousands of deaths that we die. And this is the old, and I'm getting into my message, so I'm going to have to stick to my notes, getting into the latter part of my message. We will get to that. Hearts revived, and what I'd like to focus on today is more about our heart than anything else, and revival within our hearts. God's heart is to revive us. And God, if you understand this, God also has a heart. He's got a mind, will, and emotions like we do. And he can be moved. But it says like this, God's heart is to revive us and to bring us back. And this was done in Jesus Christ. When Jesus came, he bought us back through His blood back to the original position that God wanted us to be in in the Garden of Eden, and we could go back to that, and I don't think I'm going to take time to do that. But in the Garden of Eden, He wants to restore that original condition of man back to Him so that there would be communion with God, so that there would be a relationship with Him. And this is what He wants to revive and restore and renew within us. That which, you know, in the temple, when Jesus died that day, and we know that it was law and the prophets, and it was law that was up to the point of Jesus Christ. But when Jesus Christ came, He said He's going to open the door and He's going to make a way that every one of us individually can come unto Jesus and can come boldly. And I always, this is one of my favorite verses. He says that we must and we can come boldly unto the throne of grace, where we can get help. And how many of us that go through life, we come to places that we're needy and we need help, and we look into our own lives, there's only one place, and that has been restored in Jesus Christ, that we can go directly and have the boldness to go directly to the throne of God, into His presence by Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. This needs to get us excited, may I say excited, but this needs to move our hearts again. May the truth of God, may it move our hearts again, that He has made a way for us to directly come to the throne of grace, and then He says, do it boldly. How does that look? To boldly come to the throne of grace. You can come in honesty exactly the way you are. I believe that's what it talks about when it talks about boldness. Is it boldness by saying, you know what, I can come right to the throne of grace? But I think the boldness, what it's saying is, we can come in honesty, in the honestness of our hearts. We don't have to pretend. I believe God, in the end of life, He's going to judge us what? He's going to judge us according to our hearts. He's not going to judge us according to the outward things and the things that maybe some other person or some man has thought is right and wrong about your life. But there's a responsibility within our own hearts to be clear before God. We stand before Him now, and we stand before Him at the judgment seat of Christ, when it's no one else that's going to be standing there, but it's going to be us alone that will stand there before the judgment seat of Christ. And then He will look into the heart. But now He also looks into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, and He sees what's in there. So I believe the boldness that we can have is, it's the honesty that we can have to come boldly to the throne of grace. In boldness or in honesty, we come before Him. God will not despise nor reject you if you come into His presence and you've got needs and you've got things that you need help in and you've got sin in your life and you need to get rid of those things. God does not despise nor reject. He says, come boldly unto the throne of grace. Are you with me? You look kind of tired and sleepy. Are you with me today? Amen. We come to the throne of grace. He is high. It says, God, He is high and lifted up. And He's seated on that throne. But He also says that He will also make His abode with those that are humble and contrite. Those that have humility and are contrite in their heart. Their heart is broken. Their heart is at a place, you know what? I don't have a lot of confidence, even in myself. And we never should have confidence in ourselves. We have confidence in who God is. And we trust in Him. And we have faith in Him. It's the whole... Wouldn't it be nice if we could just have all those feelings and emotions that go with us for the rest of our life? The way that we had when we became born again. At that day, all those feelings and emotions of just, whoo, doesn't work that way. But it comes down to the truth and what God says and what He's speaking in our hearts. Hallelujah. God said, He talked about David, and He said, David is a man after my own heart. And you know, we might not understand completely some of that because we look into David's life and we see some of the issues and the problems that David had. But his heart was right. We want to judge. So many times we look at others and we want to judge some of the things that we see with our eyes. But it's not in that. God will be the final judge in every one of our lives. We can give opinions, we can give ideas, but it's God. We have to give the benefit of the doubt to another sister and another brother and whoever else that we meet out there that we think, you know what, they should do things differently, they should look differently, they should do all these things. And I hope you're past this. I hope you're past this. But that God, we leave those things with God. Let God decide those things and take care of those things, because he also looks into our heart and he sees what's right and what's wrong in there. David, all the things that he messed up in, I believe he still had a heart. He had a heart. As soon as Samuel, I believe it was Samuel that came to him and said and put his finger in his face, and he told him the story, I believe, about the sheep and how there was a rich man and a poor man. And the one had all these sheep, and the rich man went and took that one sheep that this poor guy had and took him and basically took him from the poor man. And David was like, well, this guy, he has to be taken care of. We have to punish him. There's a punishment that needs to take place. And then he said, that's you. That's you. And David, and I believe when God points his finger into our hearts, the thing that we need to be is sensitive. And I believe this is how David was, that he had a sensitive heart. He knew what God was saying. And he knew immediately that this is a sin that I will repent of. And there was more than one thing that he broke here when he walked through and he did that. So David, I believe when he was confronted, and I believe this is something that we can look into our own hearts, when God confronts something or he points something out in our lives and in our hearts, how do we respond to that? How does our heart respond to that? Does it respond immediately with a yes, or does it respond, and when I look into my own heart, do I respond with some excuses and some reasons of why I have a certain thing that resides within me? Not when God, through his Holy Spirit, starts speaking, we raise our hands in surrender and we say, Lord, I have sinned. I have sinned before you. And this is the blessedness of having the Holy Spirit today working and operating in our lives. Even as young people, I remember as young people, this is something for you. Remember the Holy Spirit as he has been given unto you, and conviction that settles into your heart. Always, always be mindful and quickly change when he points something out in our lives. Quickly change when he points something out in our lives. Sometimes, you know, I've come to the place already where I said, Lord, I see things in my own life, and I don't even know how to change. I don't know how to change my own life, but I want to give and surrender my life again before you, and you take care of these things that are wrong within my heart. And he will do that. In 1 Samuel 16:7, here's where when David, and I'm not going to turn to this passage this morning, but when David was anointed king, and here was Samuel, and he said, we need to anoint a king after Saul. We're going to anoint a king for Israel. And you know how that all the sons of Jesse, how they were brought past Samuel, and Samuel was here with the oil. Might have been something like this here, James uses up here to pour oil into the lamps. But he was standing here, and as they passed before him, as the sons passed before him, all at once, even Samuel said, he looked at, I believe it was the oldest, Eliab, and he said, well, surely it's him. Surely it's him. It's the way that I see him. He's a king. He's one that he's got it all. He's tall. He's handsome. And it seems like he's got a certain authority about him. And he said, God, is it this one? No, this is not the one that I have chosen. And we know that in the end, they were all passed through, and Samuel said, isn't there, do you have any other sons? And this even shows us how that Samuel, the obedience of Samuel, he didn't know this was, he thought maybe this was all the sons of Jesse. But he was obedient to what God was telling him. That no, it's none of these, it's none of these. And sometimes we get our own, and I see decisions that we make sometimes, we get our own opinions and ideas involved in this. But what is God saying? This is what matters. What does God say about this? And even we've been going through some of this, even with our youth, you know, like clothes and things like that. They're saying, well, what is this? Is this modest? Do I wear this? And the question is being asked, well, what does God say about it? What is God saying to you? It's not to me anymore, but you come of a certain age. What is God saying to you? You have a responsibility. You come to the age of accountability and responsibility. What is God saying? Would God, is He saying, this is okay? What is the Holy Spirit saying in your heart about places that you go, things that you do, things that you wear? Yes, it's this practical. It's what's within our hearts. And God, when He asks, well, when you ask Him the question, Lord, is this right for me? Anyway, we know that Eliab was not the one and none of the other sons was. But it was David that was the one that was anointed and chosen to be the next king, be the next king in Israel. It wasn't according to the outward appearance, how things had appeared, because I believe Saul, if I remember right, Saul was chosen on that basis. That he was a head, what was it, a head taller than any man. He was tall and he was handsome and he was good looking and he was just kingly. But God looks to the heart. When He anoints, He looks to the heart. It's not about who we are on the outside, and it's not, and I'm not even talking about the physical features. And many times we look at our gifts and things that God has given unto us. You know, He gives us these gifts. He gives us gifts for the benefit of the kingdom of God. And He uses men that sometimes we looked at, and we can look into the Bible and into the Scripture, and we can see many men that God used that we would say, well, how? I mean, they had some issues and they had some problems in life. And Saul, I believe, going back to Saul, just to finish that thought, but Saul, he was based on the looks and everything, if I remember right, that's how he was chosen. And Saul, but Saul was rejected because of what? Because of disobedience to God. God looked into his heart and he saw that there's something deeper. It wasn't about just who he was to the people, but it was about walking in obedience. It was the time, I believe, one of the times was when he was supposed to wait for 7 days. God had asked him to wait 7 days on Samuel, I believe, to come and to pray when there were 3,000 chariots. And here's where we get messed up sometimes. So we see with our eyes, and Saul saw with his eyes, and he started accounting things according to what he was seeing with his eyes. And he saw it, I believe it was 3,000 chariots and 6,000 charioteers. And these, there were so many that were coming, the Philistines that were coming against him. And he waited and he waited and he waited for those 7 days. And the moment that Samuel arrived, just before that, he decided he's going to go in and he's going to put the sacrifice on the altar and to find out what God was wanting from them. But it was not his place to do that. It's not what God had called him to do. He was called to be the king, but he was not called to go in and put sacrifices on the altar and get an answer from God. That was the work of the prophets in that day. And Saul overstepped that. And I think it's so ironic. The seventh day, the last hour, maybe just, it was just before Samuel arrived. That's when he did that. And so many times, and I don't know if I said this here or not, but I was talking to somebody that was in Haiti, a man that lives in Haiti. And did I say this here? Maybe I said it last Sunday or sometime. I'm not sure if I did, but I'll relate it to you. There's people here that wouldn't have heard it. But in Haiti, I asked him the question, you know, And it wasn't an answer that what I was expecting. But I asked the question, I said, with all the witchcraft and people even knowing that they, when they go to some witch doctor for advice, and they get advice, they even know that this could cause a bondage and sickness and death and all of this in their life, why do they still go there and ask? Why do they still go and ask to put a spell on someone or to ask for advice or wisdom or look into the future for things? Why do they still go there? And he said, you know what they say? Because God is too slow. God is not fast enough. The enemy moves fast, and he wants to give you things. When it's our own way and our own will, we can, in one hurry, we can find out, and we need to take care of it, and we have no patience to wait on God. This kingdom, what I found out that we dwell in, is a kingdom of patience. We wait on God at times. We wait until he moves. Do you hear me? So many times at that last minute, might be that last hour, when it's still time, we want to do our own thing. And God is saying, wait on him. Wait on him. And I just saw another aspect of the enemy when he told me that story. I saw another aspect of the enemy, how that he wants us to move quickly and to make quick decisions and to do things quickly instead of allowing and trusting God with certain things in our lives. And I understand, I'm saying this, that we have certain responsibilities in life, and I believe you understand that. But there's also times that we wait on God. When he has said wait, we wait on him. If we think it's the last minute and we can no longer wait, we still wait on him. And suddenly he comes to his temple. And in an instant and in a moment, God can change things that look so hopeless and so bleak in your life. But as soon as we put our hand to it, we make a big mess out of things, don't we, at times? We put our own hands to it, and we want to make things happen. You know, and I we've talked about it here, and I think we've talked about it a lot, that so many times there's a promise that God gives us, and so many times he doesn't give us the timing of it. It's a kingdom of patience. That's what I'm learning. That's what God is teaching me. At this, it's a kingdom of patience. We wait on him. We wait for him to move. When he has given us a promise, when he has given us a, we wait on him. Saul, in the last minute, probably just might have been an hour, waited for 7 days. Waited for 7 days. And then he moved, and he said, I'm going to have to do something. I mean, the chariots are gathering. I mean, things are looking bleak, and they're looking hopeless. And it looks like I'm going to have to do something, and we get all... So wait. Wait on when God wants to move. And when he moves, he does it right. And he takes care of things in our life. Amen? Have you found it that way? So I'm just encouraging you again today that don't let our heart be troubled. Believe on God. Don't let your heart become troubled. Don't let your innermost, don't let those butterflies come in there. That things are not going to work out. Things, oh, we're going to have to do something. We're going to have to stick our hands in it, and then we mess it up. Let God do it. Let God do it. Wait on him. God knows our hearts, and he knows every need that we have within our hearts. I believe that. Every need and everything that we need and desire to have, he knows our hearts. And I believe God. I don't even believe. I know that God knows our hearts better than what we do. He knows our hearts better than what you do. He knows your heart today as you're sitting here. He knows your heart better than what you do yourself. Sometimes we get blinded to the things of our own hearts, our own intents, our own ideas, and our own things within our heart. Lord, show us our hearts. Show my heart today, and let me be honest before you. And that is coming boldly to the throne of grace. Throughout Scripture, we find God selecting men and women for His service. That would have not been an obvious choice that we would have looked at, but God had looked to the heart. We could go through some of these. Moses is one that stuttered. He couldn't even speak. But God chose him because of something that was in his heart. Moses, he said, I can't even speak. You're going to have to send Aaron with me. He had to make a request at one time, and this came by the working of God within his life, where God could now be his strength and power, because at one time he was known to be an eloquent speaker. Isn't that something? That at one point he was known to be an eloquent speaker until he was sent to the backside of that desert. And he was there for 40 years, and he came out of that desert and said, I cannot speak. This is the work of God. We would look at that. Moses stuttered. Well, he's not. Is he qualified or not? Jacob lied. He was a deceiver. But God changed him. Timothy had ulcers. Abraham was too old. It's not possible. The promise that God once, but this is how God works. Things that look hopeless, things where you think you cannot do it, it's the grace of God that is poured out into our lives and empowers us to walk with Him and walk in this kingdom for Him. It's not about our own strength, it's about His. Naomi was a widow, John was self-righteous, Peter was a braggart, Jonah ran from God, Thomas was a doubter, and Martha was a worrier. Doesn't it sound like some of you? Some of us? Absolutely, but God looks to the heart, and He changes some of those things. He takes care of some of those things. Are we, as when we come to God, we are not in perfection. And so many times, this is what keeps us from operating in the kingdom of God or being used, because we have to be perfected in certain areas in our life before God can use me. If God would have done that throughout history, I mean, I could throw another one in there, Gideon. Gideon was shy. He was shy. But God used him. I mean, amazing. But in all this, in their weaknesses, they looked to God for their strength and His power. And God looked, I believe God wasn't looking at the outside and looking at everything being just right and looking at everything being just right even in your lives. But God is looking for someone that is willing and has a willing heart to serve Him and has a love for Him above anything else. That there is a love that is wanting to serve Him and to give Him glory in this life. As long as you have breath, as long as God leaves you here on this earth, that we would bring honor and glory unto His name. This is what God is looking for, a heart that wants to serve Him. And not serve Him grudgingly, but serve Him with an honest heart out of love. So many times that God has spoken to me in my own heart, that so many times we want to serve, that I've wanted to serve in a grudgingly way. No, this is an honor and a privilege to be in the kingdom of God, to worship Him and to serve Him and to give Him our lives and give all of it to Him. Every part of it. It's an honor and a privilege to serve Him out of the depths of our heart. Hallelujah. I believe revival, if you want revival within your hearts, if there's a cry for a reviving within your hearts, it's going to depend on the honesty of our hearts. The honesty of our hearts. This is what God receives, is someone that is honest within their heart, and He will pour His Spirit there into that heart. It's the core again, it's this core being of who we are. And you know, there's maybe a dispute on what is the heart, that the heart is something in itself. Well, It even says there's as a man, it doesn't say as a man, but as it was talking about someone in the scriptures, as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Or as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. So there's a thinking in the heart. And I don't believe it's talking about this physical heart, but I do believe it's talking about our mind, will, and emotion, and maybe even combined with our spirits of who we really are. Who we really are. But he also, and there's some other scripture that I have for that. Romans 10:10, for with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So with the heart, with that innermost being of honesty of who we are, we believe unto righteousness, of being righteous, of accepting who Jesus is for our righteousness. And with the mouth, there's also something that comes out of us. It's words that come out, and there's confession made unto salvation. That which comes out of our mouth. And I believe God has been instructing me, or looking, as I open my heart to Him, and I'm open before Him, but He speaks things into our hearts. And He says, as you open your mouth, there's many times you need to listen to what's coming out of your own mouth. Sometimes we need our ears opened to hear of what's coming out of our own mouth. And I'm saying my own mouth. Am I hearing right? And we take note of that. For some reason, sometimes we get where we don't even hear. We get to the place where we don't even hear of what's coming out of us, out of our mouth. But with our mouth, confession is made unto salvation. It is confessing of what lies within here. Now, if our mouth isn't matching up, you know what? May I just say this? I believe our mouth matches up with what's in here. You know, there's people that, you know, you've been out on a job somewhere and for some reason they let a little cuss word slip. Well, they say, and I've had it happen to me where somebody did that in my presence. And they, oh, sorry, you know, and you know what? That's what was in the heart. There's so many times excuses made for that, but that's what's in there. So listen to what's coming out. You might say, well, maybe there's something that needs to be taken care of in our hearts yet. Maybe there's something down deep in there. Lord, change this. Change my heart. In Jeremiah 17, it says, the heart is deceitful above all things. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, and who can know it? And I believe that in the fallen state of our hearts that have not been surrendered unto Jesus Christ, and a new spirit has been given unto us, and a new heart, and the heart of stone being taken out, and a heart of flesh, as the scripture says, been put in place, that in the fallen state our hearts are desperately wicked and deceitful. And it's still a part of our lives. I don't know, we cannot, so many times we want to make excuses for that, but it's a part of our life yet. And I wonder how many times do we remember that our heart is deceitfully, it can be very deceitful. And it says it's deceitful above all things. And it's not only deceitful to you, it's deceitful to others, but it's also deceitful to your own life. Convincing you of certain things in your life that are not true. But the truth and the honesty, that's where we get down to the truth and the honesty of our hearts. Well, what is really in there? God, open our hearts to let us see. And I know, I remember when the day that I prayed and I said, Lord, might I live according to what is within my heart. And when that happened, there's things that came out and things that I started seeing in my life that I had never seen before. That it was things that were wrong in my life that I had not noticed before and known before. But may we live, what is it worth if you're living and hiding things within your heart of who you really are? Why don't get them out in the open and expose them and see who you really are, and then you can fall on your face before God in repentance. But the heart is deceitful. Just remember that. Your heart is deceitful. It can lead you in wrong paths and down wrong ways and convince you that you're right when you're wrong. And convince you that you're, I don't know about wrong when you're right, but it always wants to convince that you're right when you're wrong. Your heart is very deceitful. Remember that. The old flesh part of you is very deceitful. Not the new seed and the incorruptible seed that is within you. But I see so many times that we, if we do not allow the Spirit of God to have His way in our lives and to speak to us continually, and we suppress that and we want to do our own thing and go our own way, that this brings an imbalance in our lives. An imbalance toward the wrong things and deceitful things and things that are not right in our lives. Psalms 85:6. This was a psalm that was written for Korah's sons. And this, I thought this was very interesting. You know, we want to judge Korah and his sons. And it wasn't his sons that were, I believe it was Korah and his company that died that day. But this psalm, there was a psalm that was written for Korah's sons, the lineage that followed Korah, that was his lineage. And it says like this in Psalms 85:6. And I have here, I should read that whole chapter. But for time's sake, I will not read that whole chapter. It says, wilt thou, the verse that I want, Psalms 85:6, wilt thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? So there was revival taking place. There was a cry for revival to take place because of what had happened in the midst of them. And this was written for that, I believe it was an encouragement to the sons in saying, you know what? God, revive us again. What happened might have been wrong, but Lord, revive us again. And there was hope given again so that we might again rejoice in who you are. Not for anything else, but in who you are as King of Kings, Lord of Lords, high and lifted up. Hallelujah, and we need to move on here. Wilt thou not revive us again? Revive means, and I want just to give you a little bit of a definition of revive. And this comes directly out of Scripture. In the Hebrew or the Greek, as I looked it up, revive means to bring to life something that was dead or close to it. To live, to have life, to continue in life, to remain alive, to sustain life, to live on or upon, to live prosperously, be quickened from sickness, from discouragement, from faintness, from death, to preserve alive, to let live, to give life, to quicken, refresh, restore to life, to cause to grow, to preserve alive, and let live. And I put every one of those in there to make a point. It's all about life. What God wants to do is revive, and it's all about making alive something that was dead within us. He wants to revive that. And He wants to revive our hearts. Repentance precedes revival. Acts 3:19, it says, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. When the seasons or the times, and I believe there are seasons and times in our life for refreshing, or this is another word, refreshing for revival, shall come from the presence of the Lord. Repentance precedes reviving of our hearts. Repentance precedes reviving of our hearts. So there's always repentance involved in revival of our hearts, in reviving that which is dead and to make it alive again. We need a season, I believe, of revival. And I need a season of revival in my heart. Amen. Lord, bring that season. And I do believe that God will bring that season of revival, times of refreshing. I said something here a few weeks ago, and it came out of my mouth, that when the times of refreshing come, that we would be at the place of humility and knowing that when God is speaking, and He's speaking for us to repent in certain areas in my life, that He would bring repentance. But the whole idea of repentance is so He could bring a refreshing and a reviving within our hearts. And the other thing is, God doesn't allow and does not want sin to be reigning within our hearts. The Lord is high, but He wants to revive not the proud. And this, when I started studying for this, the thing that popped out at me over and over again is pride and proud. And so many times I believe pride, when I looked into my own life, is one of the first things that wants to stand in the place of reviving. It's God does not, he stands against the ones that are proud of heart. And when we have pride within our hearts, He stands against that. But He says like this, and we have scripture here, the Lord is high, but He wants to bring revival to the broken and the contrite, to the ones that see their condition, to ones that admit their condition, to ones that start seeing and they're broken in heart and they're contrite again in their hearts. And God says, here's what I want to revive. Even though I'm high and lifted up, I'm going to look to the lowly ones, the ones that have just been defeated, the ones that had their hearts just broken by something. Those are the ones that I'm going to come to and revive. Revive. The ones that are strong and full of pride. And if I'm full of pride and I have strength, my own strength, He's not bringing revival to those. He's bringing revival to ones that are broken of a contrite heart. And God might have just shown something in their own hearts and in their own lives, how they have just seen themselves of who I am, what has come out of my mouth, and who I am. Lord, thank You so much for that. In Psalms 138, verse 6, says, if you want to, you don't have to turn to it, but I have it here. Though the Lord be high, yet hath He respect unto the lowly, but the proud He knoweth afar off. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, Thou wilt revive me. Thou shalt stretch forth Thine hand against the wrath of mine enemies, and Thy right hand shall save me. The Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. Thank You, Lord. Did you hear that? The Lord will perfect that which concerneth you, me. He will take care of that. Thy mercy, O Lord, endureth forever. Forsake not the works of Thine own hands. Isaiah 57, verse 15, for thus saith the High and Lofty One, that inhabits into eternity, whose name is Holy. I dwell in the high and holy place, and with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite ones. When it talks about restoring and reviving here, talking about the humble and the contrite, not the opposite, the ones that are proud of heart and cannot see themselves. That's the mercy and the grace and the mercy of God coming to us and reviving us. Reviving and refreshing comes when pride that has crept in is gone and we become honest and our hearts break in humility and we see God. Isaiah. This is what happened to Isaiah. And if you want to turn to it, we will read this scripture in Isaiah 6, starting in verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and His train filled the temple. And I would like to take a little bit of a look. And my, oh my, is that an hour already?
Amen.
Uzziah. We're going to look at this, and we'll look at it in short. But Uzziah, and we've heard this preached before, but in the year that the king Uzziah, that king Uzziah died, Isaiah got a vision of who God was. Now, Uzziah, I want to show you who Uzziah was. And if we can turn to, it's in 2 Chronicles, and I'm going to read this scripture. It talks about Uzziah. 2 Chronicles 26, starting in verse 1, and I'm going to read verse 1 through 5. Then all the people of Judah took Uzziah, who was 16 years old, and made him king in the room of his father Amaziah. So he was a young man that was made king at a young age, at 16 years old. And he built Eloth and restored it to Judah. After that, the king slept with his fathers. 16 years old was Uzziah when he began to reign, and he reigned 52 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name also was Jechaliah of Jerusalem, and he did that which was right. This is what I want you to see. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that his father Amaziah did. And he sought God in the days of Zechariah, who had understanding in the visions of God. And as long as he sought the Lord, God made him to prosper. Now, we want to flip over to 16. And here, in between here, it's talking how God used Uzziah in a tremendous way. And he used him for the sake of his kingdom. And you could go through here and try to figure out what all it was, but he was very mighty in battle. And there was much deliverance that he brought to them, to Judah. And there was much deliverance he brought because of how wise he was in all the artillery that he made. There were just many things that he made. He built towers. He digged wells. He made a lot of different artillery, I believe it says in one place. And I'm not going to be reading all that, but we'll go over to verse 16. So God, basically what I want you to see is God used him in a mighty way. But when he was strong, and it says like this, once everything was going well, and he was strong, and he was fortified with armies and, you know, all of that he had, his heart was lifted up to his destruction. For he transgressed against the Lord his God and went into the temple of the Lord to burn incense upon the altar of incense. And here it says he came to the point. God was using him in a tremendous way. And he came to the point that he started being lifted up and saying, you know, God is using me in such a great way. Look at how he has fortified me. And he became strong in himself. And this is the danger of what we need to see that can happen to any one of us here. That even though we look at some of the things that we have, that God has accomplished, maybe through me, through us, being a vessel for him. And I'm not saying that in a way that is bringing honor and glory to any man. It's all about who God is. But he allowed this to be, his heart to be lifted up. And it was lifted up to his destruction. And he transgressed. And he did something that he was not supposed to do. What God had not called him to do. And God said, and after that, and I will just read, I believe we'll read down to verse from 16 or in 17 now, down to verse 23. And Azariah, the priest, went in after him. So he went into the temple of the Lord to burn incense, and this was only for the priests to do. They were anointed for this work. And Azariah the priest went in after him, and with him 80 priests of the Lord that were valiant men. And what I want you to see, I mean, there were 80 men that followed Uzziah into the temple and said, you cannot, you should not do this. And 80 men that were in front of him could not convince him not to do this. How strong had he become in his own heart, in himself. Unbelievable that 80 men could stand before him and try to stop him, and he just kept right on going. 80 men. And they They withstood Uzziah the king and said unto him, It pertaineth not unto thee, Uzziah, to burn incense unto the Lord, but to the priests, the sons of Aaron, that are consecrated to burn incense, go out of the sanctuary, for thou hast trespassed. Neither shall it be for thine honor from the Lord God. Then Uzziah was wroth, he got angry, and he had a censer in his hand to burn incense. And while he was wroth with the priests, the leprosy even rose up in his forehead before the priests in the house of the Lord from beside the incense of the altar. And I will not read the rest, but what happened in the end of Uzziah was that he died of leprosy, and he was not buried in the king's sepulcher, but he was buried in the king's field, I believe is what they called it. But the end of Uzziah was not good, all because of pride, all because that he had seen God work and use him as in the deliverance of the children of Israel. And then all at once he became lifted up in pride, and 80 men could not stop him from violating something that he was not called or anointed to do. Unbelievable. It shows us how strong that we can become even in our own hearts. Do you hear me? 80 men. When I read this story, I was like, I couldn't believe it. 80 men tried to stop him, and he just kept right on going. 80 men. Lord, let us never get to that point. May we be sensitive to what God is speaking in our hearts and what he's wanting us to do and what he has anointed us to do. But we turn back to Isaiah. So we read this in the year that King Uzziah died. And I believe it's a type of someone that has, it's a type of the flesh or our strong will within us, is I believe what it's portraying about Uzziah. Or in the beginning, he served God, but a place that he could come to and operating, and we would say in the flesh or being strong about something when it's only our own power and our own strength. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon the throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple, but not until Uzziah had died. Not until that pride had gone, repented, a death had been brought to that, that Isaiah could see a vision of who God was. And I will just read down through these. I believe I'll read down and let me see here. For time's sake, I'm going to have to. Yes, we will read down through verse 7. And it stood, in verse 2, above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain or two he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And I can see this as the seraphims and the angels, as they're worshiping the creature, as they're worshiping God before the throne. Can you see the response? And it says they cried one to another. One said, Holy, holy, holy. And the other said, The whole earth is filled with his glory. And the other said, Holy, holy, holy. And the other said, The whole earth is filled with his glory. One to another. They were speaking these things one to another. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, Woe is me. And this was Isaiah. And all at once he said, Oh, uh-oh, woe, woe is me. And I wonder if you've ever come to the place where you have seen the holiness of God and you said, Woe is me. And all at once he started seeing that his lips, what he speaks, what he has spoken, he's unclean. And may I say, when you get into the presence of God and his holiness, the first thing that starts happening, you start seeing yourself in a way that you've never seen yourself before. Because of his holiness, because of who he is. He says, Woe is me. And one of the first things is the speech that came out of his mouth. He said, Woe is me. For I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. And I believe what he's saying here, the unclean lips, the sign of the unclean lips, is a sign on condition of our hearts, of what our hearts are. Like I said before, that which comes out of our lips is a sign of who we are within our hearts. Woe is me. Woe means I'm unraveling when you come into the presence of God. Unclean lips. I'd like to turn to Matthew. I'm going to leave that and turn to Matthew, chapter 7. And here, I will not read everything here, but I will read Matthew 7, starting in verse 14. And we look at, it's that which is within us that defiles us. It's what's in here that defiles us. This is what Jesus is teaching. It's what's within the heart. It's how things are processed in here. It's how things are, for some reason, I look at, there's so many different, and what I found out in life, there's so many different responses from different people to things that happen. One might say it's this way, and another might say it's another way. Another might say it's so varied. And I was looking at this, and I was looking into my own heart and saying, Lord, why do I respond in the way that I respond? Why do I respond to things that I hear with my ears to the way that I respond? And why can somebody else hear the same thing and they respond differently? Because it's all what gets processed in here. It's the condition of who we are on the inside. Here Jesus explained it very well in Mark. Did I say Matthew? I think I did. I'm sorry. It's Mark. It's Mark 7, verse 14. And when he had called all the people unto him, he said unto them, Hearken unto me, every one of you, and understand. There is nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him. But the things which come out of him, those are they that defile the man. And he says, If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. And I believe when Jesus said that, I believe we need to open our ears and listen to what he's saying. For sure, he's making a point here. And when he was entered into the house from the people, his disciples asked him concerning the parable. And he said unto them, Are ye so without understanding also? Do ye not perceive that whatsoever thing from without entering into the man, it cannot defile him? Because it enters into the heart, it enters not into his heart, but into the belly, and goeth out into the draught, purging all meat. So there's a purging that goes on when we eat something. There's a purging that takes place. It takes out the good. It takes the good. It receives the good. And the rest is, he's saying, is disposed of. That's what he's saying here. So there's a purging that happens. When something comes in, when we eat something, there's a purging. There's something that takes place in our body. It's a purging. It's taking out that which is good. Mark in verse 20, and he said, That which cometh out of the man, that defileth the man. For from within, out of the heart of men, out of who you really are, out of the inside, where you process things, where things that are spoken, and your ears hear, and your eyes see. You know, we cannot help some things that we hear, some things that we see. But we are living in a world, a fallen world, round about us, and there's sin everywhere, and there's evil everywhere, and there's things that we see and hear that are absolutely wrong. But these things cannot defile us. It says, They will not defile a man. That which goeth in does not defile you. But when it comes out, when it becomes a part of you, and you start acting and reacting and speaking to those things that have happened unto you, those things that which have entered into your hearts. It says, out of this is where you become defiled. For from within, out of the heart, men proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, and foolishness. So all these, foolishness, pride, and evil eye, deceit, wickedness, thefts, all of this come out from where? In here. It's processed in here. It's being processed in here. Somebody that has an evil heart, a bitter person, is going to process things by the way of the mill of bitterness. Do you hear me? Somebody that has unforgiveness in their hearts, things are going to be processed, things that are heard, things that are seen, or things that come into you, it's going to be processed by unforgiveness. That's what's going to process that. So when that gets spit out again, it's spit out. The evil and the wrong is spit out again because it has been processed in bitterness, unforgiveness, or whatever the processor. May I say, you know, in a computer we have a processor. Some are faster than others, and it seems every time you buy a computer, you're always, you know, 6 months later, you need a new one because they have faster processors. But there's a processor that processes things, and it spits it out. This is exactly the way I see of what God, what Jesus was teaching here. So whatever is within the heart, whatever we harbor within our hearts, if it's unforgiveness or bitterness, this is how we process things. We need a clean heart. And when we have a clean heart and it processes, it spits, it does the work that it needs to do when things are heard and seen. It's the action, the reaction, and everything that comes out of us, our words, whatever it might be, is pure and clean if this is pure and clean. Thank you, Lord. But if this has something in there, if the heart and the processor of things has bitterness, unforgiveness, or pride, or an evil eye, or whatever else might be in there, it's like I believe somebody said, the glasses that you wear, if they're green, you see everything green. If you have red glasses, everything's red. If you have fuzzy glasses, everything's fuzzy. It's how you see things with your eyes. That's why there's such a different response, and it shows us where our heart is at. If there's law and legalism, or is there grace and love and mercy in your heart? Big difference how that we process things when they come into our lives and then when we give out is according to what's in our heart. A good man, Luke 6:45, it says, a good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good. An evil man out of the evil treasure, or the evil things that are in his heart, bringeth forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart his mouth speaks. How would you like God to treat you in the same manner that we hold others accountable sometimes when we're wrong in here? Sometimes when I'm full of something that is wrong, I want to hold somebody accountable. How would you like God to hold you accountable for who you really are? God has mercy, and God has grace, and God has forgiveness, and God has love, and He says He does not reward us according to our iniquities, but He has love and grace and mercy on those, on us. Hebrews 13, be not carried about with different and strange doctrine, for it is good thing that the heart is established in one way. So the established, if you establish something, it's a process. The way I understand it, when you establish a business, it takes some time to establish something. To establish means you have to work at it, you have to do things, there's things that take place, and you have to do marketing, you have to establish a business. And it takes patience and time. And it says here, for it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace, not with meats which have not profited them that have been occupied therein, not with law and legalism and holding everybody accountable for every little mistake that we make, that I make, that you make. But it says not in law and legalism, but it says it's good that the heart that we have, that our hearts are established in grace. This is the establishment of our hearts, what God wants. This is what he's saying in Hebrews 13. Grace, establishing grace, goodwill, loving kindness, favor. The spiritual condition of one governed by the divine power of grace that God puts within us. And we see that. There's people that are so generous and so nice and so great, we call them gracious. And this is because of the spiritual condition within their hearts. It's governed by the divine power of grace that God has put within us. Hallelujah. We can't help what we hear and see and what comes into our lives. That doesn't defile us. But it will be according to the condition of our hearts as we process things, if we have wrong in there, and how we act, react, and speak, that will defile us. Listen to your own words. The parable of the sower. I'm going to have to give this yet. The parable of the sower in Luke 8:11. The seed is the word of God. And I believe the parable of the sower is what gives us a glimpse into the condition of our hearts. And I'm not going to spend much time, but I have four different conditions that I see in this soil of our hearts and our heart's condition according to what this the sower of the seed is talking about. One is a divided heart, a proud heart, a carnal heart, and then a broken and a contrite heart. And I will go through in Luke 8:11. If you want to turn to it, Luke 8, and I'll start in verse 12. 11, it says, the seed is the word of God. And I'll paraphrase some of this and try to skip down through here. But Luke 8, verse 12, those by the wayside are they that hear. Then cometh the devil and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. And I believe this is a heart that is a divided heart, a heart that has not wholly given itself unto God. You have not, there's still a part of your heart that you have not completely given in surrender to God. It's by the wayside. It's where things you still like, you are the one by the wayside where there's much activity and many things taking place, and your eye is continually looking for these things yet. And you're maybe looking into the world yet, you're looking for things and ideas, but there's much activity. There has to be much activity around your heart because you want to know what's going on. You sit by the wayside, by the way, and you observe these things. By the well-traveled road, which is the what? The wide road. You're still sitting by the wide road with a divided heart. And it says we need to be on the straight and the narrow. Half-heartedness is something that God cannot receive. And I see that. We can talk about lukewarmness, and we know what God says about lukewarmness. But it's a divided heart. There's too many other interests, and there's too many other things that I just cannot give my heart completely to God. There's some things that I just cannot surrender to Him. It's a divided heart. It's a heart that is not guarded. There's places that are open in your heart. That's why the enemy can come and take away the Word of God so that it would be of none effect of our lives because we have not given everything completely unto God. So when your heart is still half exposed, the enemy steals that. He kills, steals, and destroys. Isn't that right? So when we have a divided heart and we haven't totally given and surrendered everything unto God, it's easy for Him to come into our fields and take out those seeds. And they become as nothing. And the Word of God becomes as nothing within our hearts. Again, looking at the condition of our hearts. There was no standard that is raised against the enemy. The enemy has all kinds of rights to your life. You struggle a lot because you're not saved in areas of your life. You struggle a lot because you haven't given everything unto God and surrendered it all and trust Him completely for it. So there's a lot of struggle in your life. You have a lot of struggle in your life in a lot of areas that you are not saved in. Salvation is, yes, by Jesus Christ. But this which we surrender unto God, He cannot take care of that which is not surrendered. Do you understand me? And we leave things exposed to the enemy. Proverbs 4:23, it says, keep, watch, and guard your heart with all diligence. Does that mean some lackluster thing? You just allow your heart to do anything? I mean, you don't guard your heart. You don't keep your heart. You just let anything come in. That's why it says guard your heart. And this is something that God has given us to do. It says guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. For out of your heart, in the depths of your heart, in who you really are, here's where the issues of life come from. It's not out there. It's not what we're hearing and seeing and coming in, but it's how we process things within our heart. Out of here, you know what? There's issues that come out of our life, and it's many times because we've processed it wrong. We've processed things wrong in our heart, and it becomes an issue. Now, the women, you know, I tell my wife many times, and this is just the way ladies are, and I'm not going to get into trouble for this, because I've told my wife this. They're experts at taking something small and making it large. How do you do that? They process things a little differently. Am I saying it's wrong? I'm not saying it's wrong. It's they think a little differently. But in the same manner, we can process things by unforgiveness and pride and whatever else that shouldn't be in our hearts, and the outcome of it is some big thing and it's not small. So it's how we process things. So it says, keep, watch, and guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. We will leave Asaph. I had a story about Asaph in there, but we will leave that. Very interesting. Till he came into the sanctuary of God. He looked around him. I'll just give you a short. Asaph. First thing, I hear a lot of people, and I hear myself say this. You look around, and you see others, and you think, ah, they have it so nice. Oh, everything's just going so hunky-dory for them. They've got a nice family. They've got a house. They've got all these things. This is exactly what Asaph said. And he became very envious. And it in his heart, it just bothered him. I mean, it just bothered him in here. And he was processing things wrong. And he just allowed, you mean you're going to allow those things and the things that God blesses others with to allow to control you? And what he said when he came into the sanctuary of God, things changed. When he came into the presence of God, all at once he started seeing what the truth was. And he saw, you know, when we come into the presence of God, all at once we start seeing what truth is. Truth about us. And we're not looking out there, we're processing things in a wrong way. But it's between us and God. You shall love the Lord thy God with what? All thy heart. With all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. The proud heart, everyone that is proud, I mean, in verse, and I'm going to try to, in Luke 8, verse 13, this is referring to this. And they on the rock are they, which when they hear, receive the word with joy, and these have no root, which for a while believe, and in a time of temptation they fall away. So the heart has no depth, because there is an underlying problem, and there's an underlying rock problem. There is an underlying problem, and it's a stone problem in your life. This is a proud heart. There is an underlying thing. There could be hidden sin in your life or things in your life that you can just not be honest with yourself, with your own heart. This is a proud heart, and I think it's so foolish to walk in this manner because God sees in there and he understands what's going on. He sees what's going on in your heart, and we simply confess before him. But for some reason, when there's sin in our lives, the first thing we want to do as a carnal person in carnality, we want to hide those things. And if there's wrong things, we want to hide them. We don't want anybody to know and see these things. But so this heart looks good on the surface. It's not a seed problem. The seed is fine. It's a stone problem. Because underneath that soil, 1 inch, 2 inches, is a rock. And when the temptations come, when the heat of life comes, that dies out in a hurry. Things die out in a hurry in your life, and you lose it. We have at home in our yard, there used to be an old road that goes through our side yard. And in this heat, it never shows up. In the spring, when there's plenty of water, when things are going well for it, it never shows up. Nothing ever shows up. But in the middle of the heat, in the middle of the summer, like now, you can see exactly the path that old road lays in, because there's only a little bit of topsoil on top of that stone bed that is there. And the grass is completely dead, and beside it is almost dead, but there's some life in it yet because of the heat. But it's not a seed problem. It's a rock problem in our lives. The carnal heart. And that which fell among thorns are they which, when they heard, go forth and are choked with cares and riches and pleasures of this life and bring no fruit to perfection. They never bring anything to perfection. No fruit that will be brought to perfection. It's only its little fruit that is never quite complete in their lives. This is a carnal heart. Now the broken and the contrite heart. But that on the good ground, where the things are processed, where the seed is sown, are they which in an honest and a good heart have heard the word, and they keep it, they guard it, and they take care of that word. They till it, and they take care of it, and they make sure that that word that has entered into their hearts, and it brings forth fruit with patience. Good soil is a balanced soil. And I could get into all this, but it says the good ground is the one that have an honest and a good heart. Having heard the word, we keep it. Psalms 51:10 in closing, and if you have any songs yet, we will turn the time. If you want to come up, I'm going to be closing here with one more verse. You know, the efforts of man over the span of time and in history and in the Word of God have never impressed God. It has never worked to impress Him by our efforts. But the confession of an honest heart, not impression of trying to impress God, that gets God's attention. Do you hear what I'm saying? I'm going to tell you again. The efforts of man over history and out of this word we can look to impress God have never worked to impress Him. But the confession of an honest heart before Him, this is where He comes and He meets us. A broken and a contrite heart. David, right after he had murdered, committed adultery, and Nathan confronted him, wrote Psalms 51. And if you have time sometime, read this whole chapter. But the verse that I want to bring to you today in the end here is, says like this, "This is the cry of my heart. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. And out of a clean heart, There are so many things and issues that are taken care of in our lives if our hearts are clean and honest before Him. But if there's wrong, there's unforgiveness, there's just wrong things in there, that's how you process things. And out of that come many issues in our life. So the cry of my heart today is, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. That's for myself, for all of us, that we would continually walk that way. God bless you. And yes, I did not go for 1 hour.